गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, लास्ट टाइम वी हैव सीन डायबिटिक रेटिनोपैथी, टुडे वी विल सी अनदर टाइप ऑफ वैस्कुलर रेटिनोपैथी, दैट इज हाइपरटेंसिव रेटिनोपैथी। द डिफरेंस इन द टू रेटिनोपैथीज आई विल लाइक टू हाईलाइट फर्स्ट, डायबिटीज एज यू हैव सीन इट अफेक्ट्स द कैपिलरीज ऑफ द वीनस साइड, वेयर एज प्री कैपिलरीज ऑफ द वीनस साइड, वेयर एज हाइपरटेंसिव रेटिनोपैथी इज इट अफेक्ट्स द आर्टेरियोल्स। Again, as far as incidence is concerned, you are already aware that hypertension affects majority of the population in India nowadays. So maybe it is more prevalent than diabetic retinopathy. Now, etiology of hypertensive retinopathy: the arteriosclerotic changes of hypertensive retinopathy are caused by chronically elevated blood pressure. So here we are seeing hypertension, where chronic hypertension or idiopathic hypertension, the arteriosclerotic changes are caused because of that, which leads to hypertensive retinopathy. So hypertension is usually essential or idiopathic and not secondary to another disease process. So we are talking about that hypertension here. Essential hypertension is a polygenic disease with multiple modifiable environmental factors contributing to the disease. So here mainly it is seen after 40 and seen with obese people, smokers, and may be associated with diabetes. However, secondary hypertension can develop in the setting of pheochromocytoma. So there is an entity like secondary, where the cause may be pheochromocytoma, primary hyperaldosteronism, Cushing syndrome, or renal parenchymal disease, renal vascular disease, coarctation of the aorta, obstructive sleep apnea, hyperparathyroidism, and hyperthyroidism. These are the causes for secondary hypertension, which may affect at young individuals. So many young patients with secondary hypertension may actually present to an ophthalmologist with bilateral vision loss due to serous macular detachment, bilateral disc edema, and exudative detachment. So in etiology, in short, we have divided into two: primary or idiopathic hypertension, where it is patient's age group is more than 40, it is idiopathic, or primary hypertension, where chronic hypertension leads to arteriolar changes in the retina leading to retinopathy. Second type is secondary hypertension, where young generation is affected because of various reasons. Again, these patients may come up with retinopathy. Risk factors for essential hypertension are high salt diet, obesity, tobacco use, alcohol, family history, stress, and ethnic background. Major risk factor for arteriosclerotic hypertension retinopathy is the duration of elevated blood pressure. So 140 above 90, more than that pressure, which is blood pressure, for a long period will lead to this type of hypertension retinopathy. General pathology. Generally, arterioles will respond to elevated pressure by vasoconstriction to reduce flow. So pathology develops when the increased pressure causes endothelial damage. So prolonged elevated blood pressure leading to vasoconstriction, leading to endothelial damage of the arterioles. Now there occurs degeneration of the arteriolar smooth muscle. So arteriolar smooth muscle get damaged due to degeneration, due to stretching of the endothelium, breaks, and leakage of plasma into the vessel wall. This leads to plasma clotting within the vessel wall, producing neural thickening and luminal narrowing. This process is called fibrinous necrosis. Then there occurs hemorrhages, retinal hemorrhages, which develop when necrotic vessels bleed into either nerve fiber layer, which will lead to flame-shaped hemorrhages, or inner retina, that is blood hemorrhages. Generally, hypertensive retinopathy is characterized by flame-shaped hemorrhages. The flame shape is because of the location of the blood into the nerve fiber layer. Then there are developed cotton wool spots. They are because of the ischemia of the nerve fiber layer, secondary to fibrinous necrosis and luminal narrowing. Then ischemia to the nerve fibers leads to decreased exoplasmic flow, nerve swelling, and ultimately fluffy opacification. exudates occur later in the course of the disease, surrounding areas of hemorrhage as a result of lipid accumulation. So, first we saw hemorrhages. The difference between diabetic and hypertensive retinopathy here is hemorrhages in the diabetic retinopathy are dot and blot. They are of venous origin. They are situated deep. Whereas hypertensive retinopathy hemorrhages are flame shaped. They are superficial. They are arteriolar origin and they are situated in the nerve fiber. Secondly, we have seen hard exudates more predominantly in diabetic retinopathy, if you remember, whereas hypertensive retinopathy is characterized by soft exudates, which are also known as cotton wool spots. Pathophysiology of these are ischemia of the nerve fiber layer, which will give rise to soft exudates or cotton wool spots, who are superficially located and they have fluffy margins. So, pathophysiology of the ischemia leading to exoplasmic stresses causing nerve swelling leading to fluffy opacification. These cotton wool spots are indicative of underlying ischemia. So, hemorrhages are, first we saw arteriolar narrowing, then we saw hemorrhages and exudates. Lastly, you see papilledema. Papilledema is a result of both leakage and ischemia of arterioles supplying the optic disc that undergo fibrinous sclerosis. So, ischemia causes optic nerve swelling and blood disc margins, while leakage causes hemorrhage and disc edema. So, papilledema is an important cause of hypertensive retinopathy is an important cause of bilateral papilledema. Effects of hypertension on eye. Hypertension may lead to multiple adverse effects. Hypertension can cause retinopathy, optic neuropathy, and choroidopathy. Hypertensive retinopathy is the most common ocular presentation. The question to the PG students is pathophysiology of optic neuropathy because of hypertension and pathophysiology of choroidopathy because of hypertension. So, hypertensive retinopathy is mainly for undergraduate students. Hypertensive retinopathy includes two disease processes: acute effects of systemic arterial hypertension or as a result of vasospasm, chronic effects of hypertension or caused by arteriosclerosis, and predispositions to visual loss from vascular occlusions and macroaneurysms. Now, there are four situations which one must consider in hypertensive retinopathy. First is simple hypertension without sclerosis. Now, this is consider age group of young patients. They have temporary stress and they have temporary hypertension episode. Now, this leads to simple hypertension without sclerosis. Now, why without sclerosis? Because they are young patients and they don't have underlying sclerosis changes in their arterioles. So, their arterioles are healthy. They are not damaged by previous sclerosis. And they have temporary blood pressure high, which is called maybe simple hypertension without sclerosis. So, now what changes you see in this? There are generalized constriction of arterioles. So, first thing is constriction of the arterioles. Before that, there can be spasm of arterioles or there can be straightening of arterioles. So, straightening of arterioles, focal spasm or generalized constriction of arterioles. These arterioles will appear to be pale and they are unduly straight with acute angled branching. There can be superficial or flame-shaped hemorrhages and cotton wool spots may occur, but hard exudates are absent. These are the characteristics of simple hypertension without sclerosis. Next category of patient will be hypertension with involutionary sclerosis. These are the majority of the patients. They are suffering from essential hypertension for a long period, above 40, occurs in older patients. Now, what is the difference between first category and second category? Because these are older patients, their arterioles are already suffering from arteriosclerosis. So, changes are overlapping with arteriosclerosis with hypertension. So, there you get changes which are similar to arteriosclerosis. So, what are the vascular signs? There is localized constriction and dilatation of the vessels with thickening of the vessel wall. Deposition of hard exudates should be seen, sometimes hemorrhages without any edema. So you don't see any edema here. Blood afferent retinal barrier is not broken. And there will be changes at AV crossings. Now these changes, as an undergraduate student, you must know, there will be nipping and a perpendicular resplendent of veins. Wherever there are AV changes, arterioles are superficial, veins are deep, there will be nipping and perpendicular placement of the veins. That is known as Gunn's cycle. But my homework to you is find out other AV crossing changes. They are Salus's sign and Gunn's sign and Bonnet's sign. So find out details of Gunn's sign, Bonnet's sign and Salus's sign. At what level you are going to see those? First AV crossing or second AV crossing? So find out that also. Then you are also supposed to find out other arteriosclerotic changes like copper wire appearance and silver wire appearance. So those are also included in the arteriosclerotic retinopathy as well as hypertension with involutionary sclerosis. Generally these changes are bilateral. And retinopathy very rarely will be confined to one eye if there is carotid artery insufficiency on that side. Third possibility of the patients is arteriosclerosis with diffuse hyperplastic changes. Again, here the age group is young. But the arterioles, which are relatively youthful, they respond to this hypertension by proliferative and fibrous changes affecting the media. Because these patients also in the kidneys suffer from chronic glomerulonephritis. And the classical picture is known as albuminuric or renal retinopathy. The vessels show evidence of hypertension, that is, they are narrow, tortuous, nicking at AV crossing, multiple hemorrhages. In addition to that, there is edema. Edema is a worst prognosis. So, what we have seen in earlier age group, edema was lacking. They had hemorrhages, they had exudates, but edema was not. Edema is a sign of breakdown of blood ocular or blood retinal barrier. So edema and cotton wool patches. Cotton wool patches are indicative of ischemia. So both these signs are showing that this type of retinopathy is having not a good prognosis. And there will be hard exudates scattered diffusely, but usually forming a macular scar in the later stages. So in addition to soft exudates, there are hard exudates also. So again, I will in short repeat, young patients, but they respond to hypertension by proliferative or fibrous changes occurring in the vessel wall. In the kidney, they are suffering from chronic glomerulonephritis. So the fundus picture is also known as albuminuric or renal retinopathy. There will be edema, there will be cotton wool spots, and there will be hard exudates producing macular scar. So chances of survival in these patients is not good because they have collateral renal damage. So if the patient survives, these changes in the fundus may regress. So treatment is not aimed at retina. Treatment is aimed at his renal damage. So the treatment is started, patient survives, fundus changes may regress. There is no treatment for retinopathy as such. In these cases, blindness may not occur, but vision is seriously impaired because of macular edema. Fourth category is having worse prognosis, that is malignant hypertension. It is an expression of accelerated hypertension. So blood pressure goes systolic above 220 and diastolic above 130 or 140. So that is malignant hypertension. Again, young arteries which are not dependent by sclerosis. Because patient is young, there is no underlying sclerosis defensive mechanism. So young arteries subjected to expression of accelerated hypertension 220 over 140. Now this is again associated with renal insufficiency. And the picture of the fundus is known as hypertension neuroretinopathy, where is domination of edema is here. So edema is a bad sign, there is breakdown of blood aqueous barrier, blood retinal barrier, fluid leaking out of the arterioles, resulting into retinal edema and papillary edema. So this is known as neuroretinopathy, and there is associated damage in the kidneys in a young patient. So entire retina may be clouded by generalized edema, which may be particularly accentuated at the disc. There is papillary edema with retinal edema. That is why the term is known as neuroretinopathy, resulting in a marked degree of disc edema with multiple corticoid patches. Hard exudates may be so profuse that patches form enormous masses, among which a macular star is often prominent. So this category of patient has worse prognosis, life expectancy is very less, and there is associated severe renal insufficiency. Again, I will repeat, there is a renal damage. Young arterioles, they are subjected to blood pressure 220 over 130, and because of renal insufficiency, similar changes taking place in the arterioles, causing breakdown of blood retinal barrier, and the fundus picture is dominated by edema, retinal edema, disc edema, and cotton wool patches, and hard exudates. So here the fundus picture is showing all that, disc edema, then hard exudates and hemorrhages, and vision is seriously affected because of involvement of macula by the edema. In such cases, particularly when disc edema is marked, prognosis is grave unless the hypertension is controlled by medical or surgical methods. If general treatment is successful, ophthalmic appearance may reduce or improve and vision improves, but the ultimate prognosis for the life is unsatisfactory. So again, my question here is, pathophysiology of disc edema, what is the mechanism by which disc edema occurs, and choroidal affection in a hypertensive retinopathy. Now there are many classifications. Your homework is find out as many as classifications as possible. I will cover Keith Wagner and Barker classification here. It is given in 1939. Old classification is based on ophthalmoscopic characteristics. This group correlated directly with the degree of hypertension and inversely with the prognosis. So this classification gives 5-year survival rate. Find out details of 5-year survival rate by this classification. It is actually no longer considered valid. There are newer classifications like Sheets classification. Find out other classifications of hypertensive retinopathy. So Keith Wagner gives grade 1 mild to moderate narrowing or sclerosis, grade 2 moderate to marked narrowing of arterioles, exaggeration of light reflex, changes in the AV crossing. Find out all other AV crossing changes. 3 is arteriolar narrowing, focal constriction, prominent AV crossing changes, edema. Grade 3, there is additional edema, cotton wool spot, flame shaped hemorrhages, and grade 4, all 3 features plus papillary. So this is Keith Wagner, no longer hold valid, but gives 5-year survival rate. Find out grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, 5-year survival rate. And find out other classifications of hypertensive retinopathy. These are AV crossing changes, Salus's sign, Gunn's sign, and Bonnet sign. This Bonnet is retina. This Bonnet sign is of. Details of Bonnet sign. So tell details of Gunn's, Salus's, and Bonnet sign in your own. This Sheets classification. This is hypertensive choroidopathy, and this is hypertensive optic neuropathy. So you are supposed to find out pathophysiology and clinical signs and symptoms of papillopathy and choroidopathy. Also, FFA pictures in all. Hypertensive optic neuropathy, hypertensive choroidopathy. So there is no treatment for these retinal or choroidal or disc changes. Local treatment, only treatment for hypertensive retinopathy is treatment of hypertension. Control hypertension, these changes will come. So this is a short topic.